Your Excellencies, distinguished guests, friends old and new. We set out in frontline 10 years ago with enthusiasm, excitement, and the unspoken promise of individual commitment. At the core of our work was the thought of all you brave defenders and your relentless work for the human rights of other people. We believed then as now that human rights defenders are key agents of social change and that there was a need for an international organisation which focused all its activities on your protection, to help build a safe space in which you could work. We wanted to be linked to you, to be a witness to your work, to recognise the value of your work, and to be fast, flexible, and furious in our determination to protect you. This was and remains our moral horizon. 10 years ago, the concept of human rights defenders was relatively new. The UN Declaration on Human Rights Defenders had just been adopted in 1998, and in August 2000, Hina Jilani was appointed by the UN Secretary General as the first special representative on the situation of human rights defenders. Over the last 10 years, it has been clear that repressive governments recognise that human rights defenders are key agents of change. It is why they have invested so much time and energy and brutality in seeking to defame, marginalise, undermine, threaten, restrict, control and eliminate them. Now more than ever, the Special Rapporteur on Human Rights Defenders should be at the forefront of the campaign to defend human rights defenders. And we strongly urge the Special Rapporteur, Margaret Sakaja, to use her second term as Rapporteur to be vigilant, brave and active in her mandate, and to defend to the best of her abilities those whose safety often relies on international protection. Fabricated prosecution and the misuse of the judicial system has now become the most commonly used strategy to silence human rights defenders across the world. Charges range from terrorism, membership of an extremist group, subversion, treason, or endangering national security, to spreading false information, defamation, organising an illegal protest, theft, fraud, or tax evasion. Indeed, human rights defender Farai Magugu from Zimbabwe was detained without charge at Harare last weekend by unidentified security agents as he attempted to join us at the platform. His belongings and flight tickets were confiscated, and he was chased from the airport by the security agents. But the good news is that he is here. Our intrepid and terrific conference organizer, Michelle Foley. Our intrepid and terrific conference organizer, Michelle Foley, simply rerouted him. Governments also continue to bring in NGO laws aimed at restricting the work of human rights defenders. Elections are often a moment of increased vulnerability for human rights defenders as well as journalists. Human rights defenders working on issues relating to economic, social and cultural rights are particularly exposed, especially when working on land rights, development projects, or the management of natural resources. Often these rural and grassroots organisations are on the front line defending human rights, and yet are less connected with mainstream groups nationally or international organisations, and are therefore less protected. Women human rights defenders continue to suffer, both on account of their human rights work, just like their male counterparts, but also on account of their gender, and particularly when they challenge cultural stereotypes. Lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, and intersex human rights defenders are at the forefront of the campaign to ensure equality and dignity for LGBTI people throughout the world. Their work can also challenge cultural norms and stereotypes, exposing them to additional risk. Sometimes they are even stigmatized by others in the human rights community, we who have sworn to uphold the values of dignity and respect for all. Frontline remembers Georges Kanouma, who so valiantly declared at this podium in 2010, "I am not going to stop fighting for my rights as someone who is gay in Burundi." Georges has since died from malaria as a result of lack of access to medical treatment. In the words of Archbishop Tutu, "Sexual orientation, like skin colour, is a feature of our diversity. Is there not already too much hate in the world without seeking to persecute those who love?" Over the last 10 years, the brutality, the torture, and the killings have not decreased. So today we honour all human rights defenders who have been killed. Many have become friends throughout the years. We feel their loss and our failure to protect them keenly. Floribert Chebeya, director of Voix des Sans Voix, was one of the human rights defenders we were in contact with from the earliest years. He participated in our first Dublin platform. We met on and off, and he was always ready to help us with assistance for other human rights defenders in Congo. A few years ago, he told me that a sympathetic security official had shown him a plan of his house and said that there was a move to attack him. Forewarned was forearmed at that stage, and so we were able to help relocate him and his family for some time. His brutal murder in June last year was a devastating blow. The brazen killing of one of the most respected and well-connected human rights defenders in Africa sent a message that no human rights defender was safe. I want to particularly remember two human rights defenders who attended the 2010 Dublin Platform and who are no longer alive. David Kato, a human rights defender with Sexual Minorities Uganda. At the last Dublin Platform, David told us of his work defending the dignity and rights of LGBTI people. He was one of the three defenders who brought a case against a Ugandan newspaper which had published names, photos, and addresses of LGBTI citizens and human rights defenders with the headline, "Hang Them." He was murdered at home on the 26th of January this year, when a man entered his house and brutally beat him before fleeing in a car. David died on his way to hospital. Betty Carino from Cactus, the Centre for Community Support Working Together in Mexico, was killed on the 27th of April 2010 in a violent paramilitary attack as she and a humanitarian group of 30 other human rights defenders, as well as international observers, were trying to deliver provisions to indigenous communities who have been under siege by armed groups. Her spirit is with us in this room and shines forth from the words that she spoke here. Today we want to live another history. We are rebelling and we are saying enough is enough. Today and here, we want to say that they are afraid of us because we are not afraid of them. Because despite their threats, despite their slander, despite their harassment, we continue to walk towards a sun which we think shines strongly. Despite all the resources that repressive governments pour into trying to destroy human rights defenders around the world and the work, the good news is that they are failing. There is increasing repression of human rights defenders because there are more human rights defenders in more countries making more of a difference for their community. And as Andrew Jackson put it, one man or woman with courage makes a majority. The Chinese government has never been able to silence human rights defenders. Their furious reaction to the award of the Nobel Peace Prize to Liao Xiaobo reveals their fear of challenges to their power. More and more courageous Chinese human rights defenders are continuing to speak out for labor rights, environmental rights, civil and political, as well as economic rights, and against corruption and the abuse of power. In the last year, the Arab uprisings have unleashed a wind of change that has rattled tyrants, not only in the Middle East, but around the world. In Tunisia, Egypt, Libya, Yemen, Bahrain, and Syria, threats and brutality have failed to quell the movement for freedom and human rights, and human rights defenders have played a key role. They will continue to play a key role, monitoring reprisals, documenting atrocities on all sides, demanding justice for the victims, advocating for just constitutions in accordance with international standards. There remain many challenges ahead in all these countries, but the lesson is that courage, determination, and hope can make a difference in the face of the most authoritarian regimes. Of course, torture and imprisonment came closer to home when our former protection coordinator, Abdelhadi Al-Khawaja, was arrested and beaten so severely that he had to undergo an operation in Bahrain in a military hospital. Many of you know of Abdelhadi and his work, supporting human rights defenders across the Middle East when he was with us in frontline. I'm sure many of our Middle East delegates were in contact with him. His track record speaks for itself. We in frontline know him to be a good man, a gentle man, one who was motivated by his abhorrence of injustice and his belief in democracy and human rights. We will continue to campaign against the sentence of life imprisonment, which has been handed down on him after an unfair trial in a military court. The recent ludicrous efforts of the Russian, Belarus, and Central Asian governments meeting in the Collective Security Treaty Organization to create a unified preventative strategy for cyberspace to restrict the use of Twitter and social networks and Facebook, if it is in their interest, shows how far they are fighting a losing battle. However, they can still inflict a heavy human cost, as those who languish in their jails can show. Innocent human rights defenders like Yevgeny Zhravtis, sentenced 4 years. Azimjan Askarov in Kyrgyzstan, sentenced life imprisonment. Alice Beliatsky in Belarus, awaiting sentence. Dilmurad Syed in Uzbekistan, suffering from tuberculosis, sentenced 12 years, 6 months. In Dilmurad's words, the representatives of legal organs circumvented the law, closed their eyes to justice, protected and continue to protect the interests of those individuals, which essentially are corruption, oppression, injustice, and lawlessness. In the path of law, it is not only me who became a victim of the courts of justice, but also my family. I have lost the people dear to me and my innocent 5-year-old daughter. I have become guilty, though I am blameless. I am not afraid of death. I live awaiting it. I lived, worked, and walked along the path of justice, caring for those around me. In spite of everything, I have always and always will be convinced that my work is right. Dilmored will not give up, and neither should we. Justice, freedom and human rights will never come easy, but neither can they be indefinitely denied when there remain those with the courage to speak out and defend the rights of others like you. In Congo, General John Numbi still needs to be properly investigated and prosecuted for the murder of Floribert Chebeya. But Colonel Daniel Mukale, who was Chief of Police Intelligence, has been convicted, and General Numbi will be brought to justice eventually. In the year when Ratko Mladic finally made it to The Hague, when Mubarak is facing trial in Egypt, when the ICC has issued arrest for Gaddafi and his son, Saif, all the brutal tyrants who remain clinging to power can no longer sleep quite as easily as they did. Assad and Kadyrov, Bashir, Ahmadinejad, and Karimov, be warned, your day will come. The artist, Irish artist Louis Labrocki said, each one of us has a voice of one kind or another, professional or personal voice. This room is full of unique voices, voices of volunteers and diplomats, international and intergovernmental organisations, board and staff of Frontline, and of course, human rights defenders, the heroes of our time. In this, our 10th anniversary, I want to pay tribute to our board, staff, and volunteers down through the years who have shaped Frontline. Every so often, my breath catches in my throat as I think of something that an individual staff member has done when they have showed commitment beyond what is expected or come up with a better way of doing things. They are Frontline defenders, and together with our volunteers and interns who have multiplied and though now scattered to the four corners of the earth doing their human rights work, have imprinted themselves into the DNA of Frontline defenders and will never be forgotten. We record their names and photos with pride. In particular, I am so glad that I managed to persuade Andrew Anderson, our deputy director, to come and work with us early on. He has been absolutely crucial and indispensable to the development of Frontline, with his wise, rational analysis and his absolutely total commitment to the protection of human rights defenders. Everyone in this room is here out of commitment or interest. A few might be here out of duty, but no matter the reason, no matter the time, each person here can bring something to the protection of human rights defenders and act as somewhat of a crowbar in the system. Many times you have to cast out, sometimes blindly, with little hope of result, taking measured professional and personal risks, so that from your voice, something good will flow. Nothing disappears into the ether. Nothing is ever lost. It just sits quietly and germinates in the fullness of time. All of us here carry around our baggage of good and bad, pride and shame, compassion and bitterness. As humans, something in all our hearts is broken, but it is in the cold, dark places that growth takes place. And we find, as in the words of Wendell Berry in his poem, the peace of wild things who do not tax their lives with forethought of grief. I come into the presence of still water, and I feel above me the day-blind stars waiting for their light. For a time, I rest in the grace of the world and am free. Dear human rights defenders, many times you have been beset with private agonies, so full of horror that you feel you cannot take any more. When despair calls out and beckons you in, yet you refuse, you endure, and you continue to spread light and life into darkness. and create hope for those who must never lose hope. You are our partners in the front line, and we pledge to be your shadows, trying to protect you and support you in your struggle. The Irish Nobel Peace Prize winner and human rights advocate, Sean McBride, said, "In the long term, we are irresistible." I say yes. Those who work for the human rights of others are irresistible. But you are also invincible because you are everywhere. You are invincible because the struggle for justice will always be stronger than the tyranny of oppression. You are invincible because you walk with faith in your goal and determination with your efforts. You are invincible because you generate enough courage day by day to get by, despite the smell of fear and the uncertainty of life. But most of all, you are invincible because you love life and living, and your work is echoed in the words of human rights defender Li Xiaobo at his sentencing on Christmas Day in December 2009 when he received 11 years sentence. Hatred is corrosive of a person's wisdom and conscience. The mentality of enmity can poison a nation's spirit, instigate brutal life and death struggles, destroy a society's tolerance and humanity, and block a nation's progress to freedom and democracy. I hope, therefore, to be able to transcend my personal vicissitudes in understanding the development of the state and changes in society, to counter the hostility of the regime with the best of intentions, and to diffuse hate with love. Dear human rights defenders, thank you for showing us the way.